By grace, I'm saved. I love the Lord and serve Him. And I'm married and have a family of girls who are all teenagers. And so I'm happy to stand before you at this Lent period and to share God's word. Let's pray. Gracious and loving Father, our hearts are open. Speak to us that we may respond and that our lives may be transformed. Use me as a vessel for your glory and honor. In Jesus' name we have prayed. Amen. So as our service sheet tells us, this is the first Sunday in Lent. So we're in the Lent period, which, as we know, is the 40-day fasting period. It started on Ash Wednesday. Some of us were here, and we got the imposition of the ashes on our foreheads in the morning, in the evening, and kicked off the fasting period of Lent. And it will go all the way until the Sunday after Good Friday. That's the 40th day. So we count 40 days excluding Sundays. So those are 6 weeks of fasting. And this is a time set aside for self-examination, a time set aside for repentance, by prayer, fasting, and self-denial, and also through reading and reflecting on God's word. You may have picked up from the collects of today, the collect for First Sunday in Lent and the collect for Ash Wednesday. It kind of sets the theme around Lent. You know, humility, we are moved to repent all our wrongdoing, restored fellowship with Him, forgiveness of sins, repentance, lamenting and acknowledging our wretchedness. All these are pointing towards what happens in Lent. It's a time to humble ourselves as we look forward towards Easter, when we celebrate the death of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ for our sins, yours and my sins, and also His resurrection, so that we might have eternal life. And so it's really a drive towards Easter. And I'm sure if anyone, or if I talked about Lent here, this period, which we Anglicans know very well, the first thing that comes into your mind would be fasting, even before we talk about anything else like repentance and these other things, or prayer. It will be fasting. And that's the topic for today. And so I want to spend the next few minutes just reflecting on a few things about fasting. So let me ask you, do you fast? If you do, when, how, why? If you do. And if you don't, why not? And it's my prayer that as we go through this session, we'll be able to answer those questions individually, because we asked ourselves individually. So let me start by, what is fasting? Fasting is abstaining from all or some kind of food or drink, and especially for a religious purpose. It can be done for other things. Doctors tell us, come tomorrow for the test, but fast. In other words, don't take anything so that you can check your fasting blood sugar. FBC, yes, FBS they call it. Okay? And also, we fast involuntarily every night. That's why we wake up and have breakfast. We break the fast, isn't it? Yeah, we've been fasting. But that's not the kind of fasting we're talking about. We're talking about a fasting that is for religious purposes. We know also other religions that do fasting, but ours is fasting as Christians fast, as the Bible teaches us, as God has commanded us to do. And that is what we'll be looking at. So there's a lot about fasting in the scriptures, both in the Old Testament and in the New Testament. A lot of people, groups of people, nations who go into fasting for various reasons. So it's not something that is new for a Christian or somebody who is familiar with the scripture. And one of the things that you'll find out when you read about these people or group of people who have been fasting is that fasting is beneficial. It has some purpose. It has some value. It is also used to seek God, as you shall see later as we continue. Fasting gives us spiritual fortitude. It grows our spiritual muscles so that we might seek God with purity of our hearts and clarity in our souls, and also be able to fight spiritual battles. So fasting helps us to be strong in the spirit. There are people also who have found fasting not helpful, okay, and for different reasons. But during the biblical era, it is very clear that fasting was found to be useful, and that is why we are going to get or learn from the Bible about it. It was very common those days. We have people like Moses who fasted. Hannah also fasted when she was seeking God for a baby. King David fasted, Elijah, Queen Esther, Daniel, all these biblical figures in the Old Testament. The New Testament, Jesus fasted. We saw last Sunday that he fasted 40 days and 40 nights. His apostles also fasted. Later years, we know men of God like Martin Luther, John Calvin, John Wesley, and others also in their lives, and you read their biographies, you'll find that they also fasted for various reasons. And today, 21st century, you are also fasting, and me. So it's been going on since those days of Moses all the way until it has reached us. So there must be a good reason why people fast. There must be a good reason why you fast and why I fast. And so we want to answer the next question. Why fast? Why is it necessary for you and me to fast? Why are all these people who have listed, why were they fasting? If you read, there'll be varied reasons. But I'd like to just mention three. Because of time, we don't have a lot of time. Number one, we fast unto God. It is to God we are fasting. And in our second reading in Matthew chapter 6, it is brought out very clearly. This is the Sermon on the Mount that Jesus is teaching. And in chapter 6, we read from verse 16, but if you start earlier on, in verse 2, he says, so when you give to the needy, then he continues. In verse 5, he says, and when you pray, and he continues. So he talks about giving, he's talking about praying. And he says, when, not if. He didn't say if you give or if you pray, but when you give and when you pray. That means that it is expected of you and I as believers to give, and it is expected for us to pray. And that we do. We've been here this morning, we have prayed several times. Yeah? And after this, we'll be giving. So there, that's fine. Then we come to verse 16. Jesus is continuing to teach. Then he says, when you fast. So again, not if you fast. It is when you fast. So just like in giving, just like in praying, we are also expected to fast. So Jesus expects you and me to fast. And when we fast, Jesus says, we should not fast for the people's sake. He says, it should not be obvious to others that you're fasting. But then it should be, but God should be able to see. He goes on to add, giving the example of the hypocrites, who are definitely the Pharisees, that they disfigure their faces to show others they are fasting. Truly I tell you, they have received their full reward, or their reward in full. When you fast, don't fast for people's sake, neither for your own sake, but fast unto God. And Jesus says, when you first put on head, on your oil on your head, wash your face so it will not be obvious to others that you're fasting, but only to your Father who is unseen. And your Father who sees what is done in secret will reward you. So when we fast, it is only God who should know. Okay? Maybe, you know, in the old days, they used to put on sackcloth, ashes. Everybody would know you're fasting. But Jesus is telling us, don't do that anymore. Fast to yourself. Let it be between you and God. I know sometimes we are challenged that I'm fasting today, and then that's when you're inviting me for a lunch at Serena. And by the time I explain to you why I can't come, you're busy insisting. And I have to tell you that I'm fasting. Then start wondering. I thought we said we don't tell each other. But you have pushed me to a corner. But basically, we fast secretly. It's God who knows, and it is God who will reward us. Remember, Jesus shared about two people who went to pray, a Pharisee and a tax collector, in Luke chapter 18. And the Pharisee prayed loudly that I thank God I'm not an adulterer, I'm not a robber. He mentioned a few things and even pointed, and not like that tax collector. Then he went on to say that I fast twice a week. And Jesus said this person was praying to himself, not to God. That fast of even counting how many times is fasting unto himself, not fasting unto God. So the first reason why you should fast is because we are fasting unto God, and Christ expects us, God expects us to fast. And we shall see later what kind of fast that is acceptable to God. Number two, we fast for personal sanctification. Personal sanctification. When you deny yourself of the good things that you enjoy, we don't deny ourselves bad things, we deny ourselves good things. And fasting specifically mentions, or rather is related to food. It is food we are talking about. Okay? So you deny yourself those choice foods, and your body grumbles. Okay? It is humbling. It's a humbling experience. And when we're in fasting and we pray, then we get closer to God. We are humbled. It deals with our pride, making us sensitive to our own sins and shortcomings. And not just us. We even see what is there in the community and in the nation, and leading us to repentance and also to pray for those ones. So fasting sets you apart, sets me apart, separate to be used of God. And in that sense, then we are drawn towards repentance of our sins. And that then makes us to be used by God. Set apart, sanctified for God's used. Number three, seeking God. The other reason for fasting is to seek God. And I think this is where most of us, this is the reason most popular. And in reading Isaiah 58, which was our first reading, we even see the Jews in exile were complaining in verse 3. They said, why have we fasted and you have not seen it? Okay? They are complaining to God that you have fasted, we have humbled ourselves, and you have not noticed. Okay? So fasting also helps us to seek God. And this is usually through prayer. And that's why you find fasting and prayer are always together. We could talk about prayer and fasting. Okay? Fasting, you must pray. Usually, you would pray. Praying, you might not fast. But fasting, you would pray. And when you are willing to subject your body, deny your body all these things so that you might seek God, then it shows that is truly coming from the heart. And somebody has said that fasting without prayer is hunger strike. And so don't go on a hunger strike, which is a worldly way of drawing attention, but fast and pray to seek God. And we have examples in the Bible. David fasted and prayed when his son, who came as a result of his relationship with Bathsheba, was sick and was going to die. He was pleading for God to save his son. So he fasted and prayed. Nehemiah, when he had about the state of the wall in Jerusalem and the gates being burnt, he needed permission from the king in Babylon to go to Jerusalem to lead the rebuilding of the wall. He prayed and fasted so that he might find favor with the king, so that he might go there. And God answered his prayer. Daniel, when the 70 years of captivity were coming to an end, Daniel in chapter 9, he says he prayed and fasted and in sackcloth and ashes so that God could facilitate the return of the Jewish nation back from exile, from the 70 years of exile. And we also see in the New Testament congregations praying. In Acts chapter 13, the church in Antioch were worshiping and they were praying. And the Holy Spirit then told them, set aside for me Barnabas and Saul so they can go and do some work. So seeking God through prayer. And we as a people here, we can pray individually, seeking God for many things. For your career, some of you are seeking for your spouses, some of you for your children, some for family needs, others for whatever need it is, you can seek God. And you can even seek God as a congregation, as a church, for a particular purpose. In 2 weeks' time, on 24th of March, we'll be having our AGM, Annual General Meeting. And that's a time when we come together, all of us, as members of this cathedral, to listen to the report from the church leaders, for ministry, and also the account. And it's really a time to engage and know how our church is doing. But we also take that opportunity to elect people to lead us, the Parochial Church Council, the PCC. And it's a serious matter. And therefore, it's also a matter for which you as an individual can also commit it to God, seek God through prayer and fasting. But you can also do it as a congregation and say, we're going to pray so that God may lead us to the right people to be nominated and for the right people to be voted on that day so they might lead the church. So you could be here seeking God for various things, your personal needs or matters to do with your family, your spouse, your children. Praying and fasting is one of the methods or tools you can use to confirm and know God's will. And we must be very clear here, friends, that when you're praying and fasting, it is not a demand, or you're not twisting God to give you what you're asking for. You see, the Jewish in exile in Isaiah 58 were saying, we have fasted and you've not heard us, you've not recognized. Perhaps what they are asking for, they are not getting. And so when you're saying you pray and fast, does not mean that you're going to twist God. It is actually to surrender yourself to God's will. And there's nothing wrong in telling God your heart's desire. Tell him exactly what you want. Tell him, God, I want A, B, C, D. I want you to do for me A, B, C, D. And then you add, but not your will, but my, not my will, but your will. That's what Jesus did. Jesus, when he was faced with the cross at the Garden of Gethsemane, it was heavy on him. He prayed, let this cup pass. Yet, not my will, but your will. So it's perfectly legitimate to tell God, I want A, B, C, D, but not to demand. And then you go for a fast, and you're twisting, and you're checking the clock and time. This God is not answering me. No, God is sovereign. He's supreme. He knows the beginning from the end. And he can answer you by giving it to you. He can delay giving it to you, or he can deny you. So pray, make your request known, but subject it to God's will. So when we are fasting, we are also humbling ourselves and surrendering to God's will. So those are the three reasons I've picked for purposes of this someone to show us why we fast. Fasted to God, personal sanctification, and also seeking God for our various needs. But remember, the biggest benefit of fasting is growing that spiritual muscle, so that our relationship with God is deepened, but also in within the spiritual sphere, we have fortitude to fight the battles. Let's look at the types of fasting. There are three main types of fasting. Some people add others, but let me talk about the three main ones. The first one is the normal or regular fast, abstaining from all food, solid or liquid, but you still drink water. So you don't eat food, you don't drink other juices, liquids, tea, coffee, juices, but you drink water. So it's water only. That's what you're calling the normal, a regular fast. An example is what Jesus did in the wilderness for 40 days. Number two, absolute or full fast. In this one, you abstain from all food and all drinks. Nil by mouth, nothing. Now, this is a tough one. And it is recommended you should never do it for more than 3 days. Because again, you don't want to fast and put your body into trouble. You can't stay without water for more than 3 days. Other health issues will crop up. And in the Bible, people who have done this type of fast have actually not done for more than 3 days. Esther, Queen Esther, when she asked her and Mordecai and the rest, pray so that as she goes to the king to ask for permission for her people, it was for 3 days fast. When Saul was converted and he was blind, he went for 3 days without food, without drink. Maximum 3 days. That is the absolute fast. But I must mention that in the Bible, you'll find two people who did this absolute fast, but for 40 days. In fact, Moses did 40 days twice. Okay? And Elijah did 40 days. Now, this is supernatural. It is not the usual. Okay? So I'm not sure you want to desire that one. But you can see how Moses and Elijah were people who are very special. And they appeared even with Jesus in the Mount of Transfiguration. So they were able to do. Other than those two, don't do absolute or full fast for more than 3 days. The third one is partial fast. This one is more of dieting. Okay? You say, I'll not take this, I'll not take this. I'll fast chapati. For me, that's a delicacy. For some people, chicken is a delicacy, fish. Okay? Some will say, I'll not eat food with coconut. Okay? Daniel ate no choice food, no meat, no wine for 21 days. That was a fast. Okay? So you can have that kind of a fast, omitting a specific meal from your diet or refraining from certain types of foods. That's a partial fast. Now, some people have added a few others, including a sexual fast from 1 Corinthians 7:5. For married couples, that is. Okay? Mutually staying away from each other for a period for the purpose of prayer. Okay? That may not be very common, but I'm just mentioning it. It is there. But it must be mutual. You don't fast for the other. You must agree to fast, both of you, in marriage. So when you fast, it is important to know which type of fast you're taking, either full or regular or partial, because it has effects, like I've mentioned, when I talk about absolute. Don't take a fast which will damage your body. Again, your health situation will have to come in. If you're diabetic and some other conditions, they might not allow you some types of fast. And therefore, you have to be guided. And please seek guidance. Okay? Don't just go into it and then you get injured or you get problems. You deprive your body of nutrients and then you say, this is what fasting did to me. No. Fasting in the right way actually has benefits for your body. When you fast, you deny your body some types of food, your body gets a time to cleanse itself naturally of some of the things, what we call detox. It does it naturally. So there is benefit in fasting. Although you can also lose weight, eh? And it happens. But that should not be your aim. But now I want to drop from 70 kilos to 60 kilos. Ah, nilent. So let me fast. That's not a good reason to fast. Are you together? Yeah? You'll fast, true. You'll lose weight, but that's not a good reason to fast. We are saying we fast unto the Lord and we seek Him and Him only, so that we get personal sanctification, but also that our bodies are renewed and that we also gain from our relationship with God. So do not use fasting to cut down your weight, but fast in a manner that makes it possible for your body to continue operating, yet you're subjecting it to its limit, but not crossing that limit. Because fasting, you'll suffer. Hunger. There'll be hunger pangs. Okay? Yeah. I was telling the first service that one of the days when I was fasting, I happened to be invigilating an exam. And my stomach started misbehaving around noon. That bad one. And you can imagine students are sitting. I'm going around. They are signing the attendance sheet. So I'm going around. Students are at this height. They're sitting on the desk doing the paper. And I'm passing and my stomach is growling. Not a very good thing. Okay? So you'll suffer that. The cravings will come back. But also remember, as we learned last week, you'll be at your weakest, physical weakest. And the devil will come to attack you. So a fast is a serious spiritual exercise. That's why I say you build your spiritual muscles when you fast. Okay? When the devil comes at that moment of weakness, like we learned last week, like Jesus, you will be able to ward him off when your fasting is unto the Lord and not to yourselves or to other people to see. So those are the types of fasts. Quickly on from Isaiah 58, let's see what type of fast or what is the acceptable fast that God talks about and true fasting from Isaiah chapter 58. And it is important that we take this because this is God speaking. Okay? It's not a book written elsewhere or anybody or myself. This is God's chosen fast. And he says it very clearly through prophet Isaiah. And here, as you saw earlier, the people are complaining that they've fasted and God has not responded. They've humbled themselves and he's not noticed. But then God goes on to tell them, but what type of fasting is this? You quarrel, you fight, you oppress each other, and you cannot fast today and expect your voice to be heard in this way. He tells them, that's not the kind of fast I have chosen. The kind of fast I have chosen is this. And then he starts enumerating there from verse 6 of chapter 58. And the kind of fast God has chosen is one that is accompanied by acts of charity. Good deeds. That accompanies a true fast. You'll release those who are bound unjustly, or those who are oppressed. So it is saying you deny yourself and share with others. Share your food. I like share. You know, there's a difference between sharing my food and giving you food. You know, I can go and buy food and give you and I still have mine, isn't it? Sharing my food means it is what I have, part of it I give you. Provide shelter to the homeless. Clothe the naked. You may not bring everybody who is homeless into your fold, but you can help provide shelter for them. You can help a community project, can help a government project for sheltering the homeless. Clothe the naked one. Give clothes, not necessarily the ones which can't fit. Some of us, when you got married, our waists were 26. Now they are 40. So those trousers of 26 are the ones which we are giving. What is happening here is that when we fast, we deny ourselves. But we don't deny ourselves so that we save. We deny ourselves so that we can bless other people. Attend the needs of your family. If this is your kind of fast, then God has said he will reward. And in verse 8 to 12 of that chapter, he lists the reward. You'll be successful in what you do. You will be healed. The things that you do right will be known and acknowledged. In other words, your righteous acts will be, you've done them in secret, but God will cause them to be exposed. People will see and say, indeed, that person has God's favor. And God's favor will follow you all the days of your life, serving him faithfully in his body. So, how can we apply this? Our theme this year is seeking God's kingdom. And even as we seek God's kingdom, some of the things we've done is in giving, also in praying. We can also seek God's kingdom in fasting. As we've seen in the Matthew, I said earlier, when you give, not if, when you pray, again, not if, when you fast, again, not if. So, we are expected to fast. If you have never fasted, remember I started by asking you, do you fast? If your answer was no, maybe you should be, by now have answered, why not? Maybe you didn't know, but Christ expects you to fast. Okay? So prayerfully ask God how and when you're going to begin. Again, I said there must be a reason why you're fasting. You don't just fast for the sake of it. There must be a reason. But start slowly. Miss one meal. Miss one type of meal. Then go on to 2 days, 3 days, incrementally, so that you don't damage your body. Get some help. Read some literature. I got a lot of help when I got saved and I wanted to fast. I read a book by a writer called Arthur Wallace, God's Chosen Fast, a spiritual and practical guide to fasting. And that has helped me over the years. And some of the things I'm sharing are from there. And there are many other books and write-ups from the web. But be careful that they talk about scripture-based fasting. But if you've fasted and you're continuing to fast, and perhaps even fasting now during the period of Lent, then it's also a good time to evaluate yourself. What kind of fast do I have? Do I qualify for God to say that this is what you're doing, the fast the way I chose, and therefore the reward is coming? Or will God also rebuke me like he rebuked those Jewish exiles? Are you fasting unto God? Are you getting personal sanctification as a result of fasting? Is it leading you to repentance? Leading you closer to God? Having a hunger and thirst for his word? Is your fasting also accompanied by good deeds, by acts of charity, as you've seen in Isaiah 58, because that's God's chosen fast. If not, again, prayerfully, seek God for guidance and say, God, I want to fast the way you want me to. I want to fast in a way that is acceptable to you. I want to fast unto you, not unto me, not unto people, not to, so Reverend Apella can tick. He doesn't have such a register, but even if he had, he would not know to tick that you're fasting, but that God in heaven, who sees your heart in secret, so that he will reward you. Many of us perhaps are fasting this Lent. I'm one of them. I like fasting during Lent, and of course other times. And you can fast as many times and as often as you deem fit, as long as there's a good reason to fast. And during Lent also, there are many things that you can fast about and join other Christians in fasting. One of the things that I do when I'm fasting is deny myself, say, lunch and 10 o'clock tea in the office. So then I take a meal in the morning until in the evening. So I don't buy lunch. Perhaps you also have a similar one. Now, I make some savings from that lunch. Now, those savings are not supposed to be for me to put in the pocket and say, hey, this year I saved during Lent because I did not eat lunch. It's true, you have saved some money. If your lunch is 50 bob times all those days, it's a lot of money. If it's 200 bob all those days, if you're blessed enough to be going to the serenas of this world again, that's a lot of money. What will you do with that? From reading of Isaiah 58, that money is not for your saving, but it is to go and help those in need. And you talk about those who don't have shelter, those who don't have clothes, that you clothe them, those who are oppressed, you free them. That saving should go for such a purpose, not to increase your bank account or your pocket money. Jesus in Matthew 25, when he talked about the sheep and the goats, he talked about when I was sick, you visited me in hospital. When I was naked, you clothed me. When I was in prison, you visited me. It is such act that he's talking about. And when you fast and submit yourself to God, then he'll lead you to those acts of kindness and compassion. That is the acceptable fast for God. Now, for food, it's easy. Because if you say, this month we'll not eat chapati, or we'll not eat chicken, or we'll not eat meat, you see, you've saved some money. So you can put that money at the end of the fasting period to help the needy. Clothe somebody, give shelter somewhere. Okay? In the 21st century, it's not in scripture, I have heard there are people who fast other things than food. People fast TV. People fast Facebook. Instagram. You've heard of that? Yeah, say I'm fasting Facebook from today until end of Lent, no Facebook. Or okay, maybe that's too much. Okay, from 6 a.m. to 6 p.m., no Facebook. Then at 6 p.m. I get back. Well, if you call that a fast, and using the principle you're learning here that you're denying yourself, you're sacrificing so you to help others. So after fasting Facebook, how do you help somebody in need? Yeah? I don't know. Would you have saved airtime? You donated to somebody who's in need? I don't know. Yeah? You fast watching TV. Leandro. I don't know those things. What are they called? Soap operas. That time, because maybe that's the only thing I can say. Okay, you've saved on electricity. That might not help much, but it's also there. But also time. During that time, how can somebody else benefit? Because you have fasted watching a Niger movie. Yeah? Maybe you call somebody and pray with them. Or if it's daytime, you go visit people in hospital and pray with them, sick people. I'm just thinking, because I don't know how to fast things. Me, I know how to fast food. Okay? But I've heard, and I know people tell me I'm fasting. This time I'm fasting social media. So I'm thinking, okay, so what do you do? So think about that. Maybe use the time to pray. Reverend Apele in the morning told us, give your computer. Did he say, give your computer to somebody? Yeah, you've helped somebody. Fasting is a spiritual practice that is expected of all believers. All of us. When you give, and we give, we are about to give. When you pray, we'll pray again, and we continue praying. Jesus also said, when you fast. So we are expected. So those of us who have never fasted, we are encouraged to start fasting. For those of us who have been fasting, continue fasting. But then ask God to help you so that we are fasting in the way he chose us to fast. Fasting builds spiritual fortitude, spiritual muscle. It's a spiritual journey we are in, and we need that spiritual strength to go through the spiritual journey. Fasting helps in building that spiritual muscle. True fasting is sanctifying. It sets us apart to be used by God, for God's use. As you seek God's will, he also reveals to us that which he wants us to do. And that is why when you are called upon to do something, go and pray and fast. Seek his will. Let him reveal to you whether it's true you should do that or not, whether you should go that way or not. Fasting helps that. Fasting is also a sacrifice. You deny yourself, but not so that it is a saving to you, but so that you can bless others who are in need. That is God's chosen first. And God will reward you. We have seen it in the Matthew passage, Jesus said, and we've also seen it in Isaiah 58. So the basis of scripture, we know what kind of fast God requires. So the challenge to you and the challenge to me is, what type of fasting are we practicing? Is it the God-chosen fast? If not, that is where we should go. And fasting will draw God, will draw you near to God. And as you draw near to God, He will also draw near to you. So as we go out and during the Lent period, let us fast just as God intended for us to fast, so that His name will be magnified. I share this in the name of God, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. Let me pray as we... Father, we have heard you speak to us about fasting. It's been a challenge to many of us who have started, and even those perhaps who have never started. Lord, I pray that for each one of us who have heard you speak this afternoon, that in our hearts we'll be set apart for you, that when we fast, we'll fast truly and truly to you, and that, Lord, you'll help us to also to be a blessing to those others, just as we have read in your word. So I pray for each one of us that you'll guide us and direct us, and especially during this period of Lent, that even as we go out this afternoon, that when we come back another time, we'll have testimony of you having guided us as such. We honor you and glorify you in the name of God, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen.
And sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee. How great thou art.